Well, good afternoon, everyone. It's really wonderful to open this academic year and see so many students and colleagues and friends here today at SEPA to start the academic year with our first public event being a lecture and discussion with Martin Wolf, Associate Editor and Chief Economics Commentator for the Financial Times, and also a Columbia Global Fellow, which means that he comes and spends a little time with us when he's in New York. Now this is the third year, I think, Martin, that you have done this. And we have been talking about the Euro crisis since his very first speech here a couple of years ago, but now we have framed it wonderfully as he has in the long goodbye. So I'm very excited to welcome Martin back to our campus, one of the most influential and well-respected writers on the global economy of our time. And his most recent book, which he gave us some preview of last year and has come out with great success, The Shifts and the Shocks, What We've Learned and Have Still to Learn from the Financial Crisis. It's really an important book. And today he'll discuss this further. I note that about half of our students are concentrating in international finance and economics and development in some way. And so this conversation is enormously important to us, and we're very excited to have you here. Without further ado, please join me in welcoming Martin Wolf.
So, thank you very much for that very kind introduction. It's a very satisfactory relationship I have with Columbia. I like coming to lecture to intelligent, thoughtful people who will ask questions I can't answer. It's how one learns, and unlike most academics, I don't spend my time lecturing to people. So that's a pleasure. And in return, and I get a very nice title, which I like. It sounds respectable, and I hope this Columbia gets something in return. I'm cheap, I should say. I took off my jacket because I find the climate here absolutely unbearable at the moment, and though I came here a half an hour ago, I'm still hot, so I felt that it would be better to take it off. I hope you don't mind. I'm not so debased that I can take off my tie. Now, what I'm doing today is this, and to explain it. Some of you, I know in academic institutions, the turnover of people, particularly the younger people, is very high, but some of you might have heard my lecture a year ago about my book, which was just about to come out at that stage. And it was, in fact, I think, almost the first lecture I gave on my book, certainly the first in the United States. And my book on the crisis was published in September of last year, and so almost exactly a year ago. And I effectively completed it about 6 months earlier. So the book was current as of very roughly January or February 2014. And what I want to do mostly today is to talk about how I see what's happened since then in the context of the analysis of the book. And obviously that involves going back to some extent on events which are covered in the book. But it is an attempt to look at what has happened since then. And the reason I feel comfortable about doing this as a lecture is the book is about to appear in paperback in November. And my publisher, Penguin, Penguin Random House, I think, was very keen that in some way the paperback version be different from the book. I can't imagine why. So after thinking about it a lot, I really didn't want to revise the whole book, which would have been an unspeakable effort. It's an enormous effort to produce a book. I simply didn't have the time. And I hate going over past work anyway. My desire always is to move on. I do things, it's done, and I move on. So what I decided to do instead, and the relevance of this is, I hope in a second be directly clear, is to write an afterword chapter, which is the last chapter now of the book, on what's happened since then and what it means. And my lecture today is about that chapter. So it's essentially saying, it's essentially based on that afterword, with a few wrinkles, obviously, it's not exactly the same. And this afterword is not an attempt to be comprehensive. It's not an attempt to go over all the issues I discuss in my book. There are many things which I think are really more important, which are structural and fundamental, which I discuss in my book. But I think it does deal with some very interesting questions. And the most interesting one is the one implied by this title, the origin of which I think all educated Americans will know, and if not, look it up on Google, and the long goodbye. And the reason I use this rather wonderful title, I like literary titles, my present book's last chapter was called The Fire Next Time, another, of course, very great American writer. The reason I use this title is that as will be emerge, that for perhaps the most important thing about this crisis is how long its shadow has been. We are still very, very clearly, unambiguously in the post-crisis world. And one way of thinking, of seeing that, just one of many, is the debate we are having at the moment. If you look at, open the Financial Times this morning, you will see how vigorous it is. I am a participant in that debate this morning. Larry Summers is. Richard Fisher, former president of the Dallas Fed. And the issue is, should the Fed raise its rates from effectively zero? So here we are, almost 7 years after they hit close to zero, which was December 2008, so very nearly 7 years ago. We're having a debate on whether it's sensible to raise rates above this floor, it's quarter point. And well, you can't really have a better indicator that we are not back to anything like the pre-crisis world, because it's almost as if you didn't know. And by the way, the consensus of opinion, I think, of most macroeconomists is that they shouldn't. They should leave things, certainly my view. So that's, I think, a pretty clear indication, 7 years after the crisis, that we're in a very unusual world. And the second reason, I think, and I'm going to come to this at length, is that it's pretty obvious to me, and it's now been obvious to me for a long time, and I've been arguing it, that China is going to hit some of the same problems. And I expect zero rates in China, or close to zero rates in China within the next year or two. I may be wrong, but that's my guess. You can see the People's Bank is cutting rates consistently. And it's cutting rates consistently because it's very concerned about the extent of the slowdown. And the reason they are concerned is that structural and cyclical forces are driving China in some ways. Of course, it's very different. It's a huge developing country still growing much faster. But it's growing into this excess supply condition with which we've been familiar in the developed world, most of the developed world now, for 7 or 8 years. And we aren't out of it. And that's why I call it the long goodbye. So what I'm going to do is cover quickly, probably the next 40 minutes or so, and then I'm very happy to entertain discussions. And I would like to stress this isn't a comprehensive discussion. I don't begin to answer every question, but I think I raise some. First, the shadow itself. So something about where we are in the world economy now and how that's evolved since I wrote. Then I'm going to focus on one or two policy questions. And to me, The most interesting policy questions I'm going to focus on there will be about developed countries, because that's where the crisis originated. I don't have the time, and I didn't have the time. I decided consciously not to discuss at length in this afterward, because it would involve many, many, many more pages, and the book, which is now going to be, alas, 500 pages, would get insanely big, because I've just added an afterword to an already large book. So I don't discuss China, but I discuss productivity, potential growth, fiscal policy and monetary policy in the developed world. Then I'm going to talk about four lessons of the crisis, some of which overlap with what I said before, and then I'm going to talk about my fears, what I worry about in terms of the implications of this crisis and the world it has put us into. So that's what I'm going to do. So I think it's become increasingly obvious now, as I said, in 2015, that this was a watershed moment in the world economy, in that the developed countries are now recovering, but their growth rates are extremely slow by historical standards, even by pre-crisis standards, which there was already a slowdown. And it's really clear that unless something very big happens, that the potential growth rate of the developed world has collapsed. And that's partly for demographic reasons. We knew about that. And so I don't focus on that, because it's just one of those things that's happening. But it's even more significant, in my view, because productivity growth has collapsed. And that's pretty well universal across the developed world. But it's more it's worse in some places than in others. So that's a very big fact about the world we now live in. And understanding why that's the case and whether it will continue is crucial, because from an economic point of view, as I think Paul Krugman said, productivity isn't everything, but it's almost everything. In the long run, standards of living are basically determined by long-term productivity growth, output per worker, or output per import, unit of imports more broadly, if we want to be more technical. The third point I want to make is that partly because, in my view, of what happened after the crisis, and partly because of what's happened to the developed world, and partly because of things that are going on within emerging economies, and above all China, the emerging economies are now in very considerable difficulty. And that looks to me like the next leg of the crisis, the rolling crisis. And I think it's to some degree related, because one of the reasons that China has entered this very difficult period, in my view, is that the crisis itself forced China into an exceptional period of credit expansion, with whose consequence is it's now struggling. So let me start, just to give you an idea of this, with a series of forecasts. It's a very clear and very stark chart, and it shows the world we live in as opposed to the world we thought we would live in 2007 and 2008. So these are successive IMF forecasts for the aggregate GDP of high-income economies. Now, obviously, the first forecast is autumn 2007. The second forecast was produced at the time of the peak of the crisis in autumn 2008. And the last forecast was produced at the end of last year. This is just a succession of forecasts. And the period before 2007 was history. And you can see two things which are pretty startling. One, the aggregate GDP of the industrial countries is vastly smaller than people expected. Basically, very roughly speaking, the aggregate GDP of the industrial countries is about, depends on the industrial country, between 10 and 15% smaller than previously expected. And second, though this is not actually shown in the chart, but it's clear, it's because it's not logarithmic, but it's clear if you look at it, not only is the level of GDP much lower, so is the growth rate. The growth rate, in fact, is roughly half potential growth of what people expected before the crisis. So this is a very long-term legacy. Now, we've known for a very long time that very large financial crises tend to lower levels of GDP permanently. There are losses in crises that are permanent. But losses in growth rates are not universal after financial crises. It's quite common for countries to have very large financial crises to have a loss in levels of output, but then to return to pre-crisis growth rates. One of the most famous examples of this good outcome of a crisis was Sweden in the early 90s. So they got back to the pre-crisis growth rate. The developed world as a whole, we're talking really about the developed world as a whole, because this was a crisis of the developed world as a whole, is not in this happy situation. Our potential growth rates are now roughly half, slightly more than half, of what was expected before the crisis. And nothing since then, by the way, has changed it. I could have put in April 2015, it wouldn't have changed this story. So it's a very long and deep shadow in terms of levels and growth rates of GDP. To put it another way, we've been sharing out losses relative to the pre-crisis trends, and people were thinking in terms of expected improvements in living standards in most countries ever since the crisis. The second feature of the crisis I want to focus on is what has happened to labor markets. So I put in here four economies: the US, the UK, Germany, and the Eurozone. I'm going to point out that Germany is the one country that feels better off in probably every possible respect today than it did before the crisis. And one of the reasons is this line, which is its unemployment rate has fallen to very low rate levels, at least by recent standards, not by post-war standards, by the way, when unemployment in Germany was generally just about zero, but still very, very low and continually falling. GDP per head was growing very slowly in Germany before the crisis. It's been growing fairly slowly since, but it's no worse. So Germany has not been adversely affected by the crisis at all. In the US and UK, we had very large, sizable rises in unemployment immediately after the crisis, which have since slowly, very slowly fallen, though they are still, in both cases, above the pre-crisis level. But in terms of unemployment, not employment, and that's particularly true for the US, but I don't have time to go into that further, the labor market has, in those two cases, almost returned to where it's before the crisis. Another aspect of that, the productivity aspect, I'm going to come to in a moment. And then finally, I put in the Eurozone as a whole, which actually includes Germany. I haven't been separated them all out. And you can see that the Eurozone's unemployment as a whole remains very highly elevated relative to pre-crisis levels. It's falling very slowly from about 12%. And if you take the unemployment rate, and this is a figure I got from Ben Bernanke, for the Eurozone without Germany, it's closer to 14%. So the Eurozone is still very clearly in the middle of the crisis in terms of labor market, and that's how most people feel. The other thing that is worth noting from this chart, because it's something that I talked about last time, but it's brought out very, very clearly, is that the Eurozone very obviously had two crises, where the others just had one. And the first crisis was the global financial crisis, which hit in 2008 and pushed unemployment to 10%. And the second crisis was the Eurozone crisis, which essentially started in 2010 and reached its peak in 2012. So the Eurozone shared in the global crisis, and that then triggered a crisis all of its own. And I discuss that in my book. So having had two crises, repair has been much, much more difficult for the Eurozone than it was for the US or UK in terms of the labor market. And this is also shown, and this is a chart I've never used before, didn't use in my book, so I put it in now. It's one I've become increasingly like using because it brings out what's happened to the two major economies of the developed world. Remember, the Eurozone and the US together account for about two-fifths of the world economy even now. So we're talking about enormous economies. Is this shows what has happened to GDP and real domestic demand in the two major economies since the crisis. If I look at the US, we had both economies had very similar recessions. The US was somewhat milder, but they both had very deep recessions in 2009. That was the first such recession since the 30s. Everybody knows that. Since then, interestingly, the US has had a remarkably steady and remarkably slow, by its own historical standards, recovery. The real GDP has been growing consistently at about 2% a year since the trough. Nominal GDP, as I show in my column this morning, has been growing at incredibly consistently at 4% a year, consistent with inflation, just a little bit below 2%, and the measured obviously on the GDP deflator. Real domestic demand in the US collapsed somewhat more aggressively than the real GDP in the immediate aftermath of the crisis, and that coincided with an improvement, it had to, by definition, in the real external balance of the US. This then didn't change much, and ever since, real domestic demand and real GDP in the US have been growing at about the same rate. As I said, this 2% growth rate for a US recovery, though incomparably better than the Eurozone, is the slowest recovery, as far as I can see, in US historical experience. And I'm including the recovery phrase from the Great Depression, admittedly from a much, much deeper recession, the recovery in the early 20s, 1920s. I haven't gone back earlier than that. So this is an astonishingly slow recovery, but nonetheless a recovery. The Eurozone is very different. Real GDP, which I've shown in red in the last quarter available, which was the second quarter of 2015, was still 2% below the pre-crisis peak, which was 7 years earlier. So over that period, never mind growth rates, the level hasn't returned to the pre-crisis level. So when I talk about the Eurozone recovery, my tendency is to say, recovery, what recovery? There is no recovery. They're not even back to the starting point. The first difference is positive. As you can see, the trough of GDP was in the first quarter of 2013. And that's not an accident, because that was the point at which Mario Draghi's outright monetary transaction program, sometimes called the We Will Do Whatever It Takes program, actually reversed extreme panic. More interesting still is the radical collapse of real demand in the Eurozone, which is still 4% below the pre-crisis peak, as the real demand in all the crisis hit countries collapsed, and there was no expansion of any significance of real demand anywhere else. So a large part of the recovery of GDP in the Eurozone has been because of the improvement in the Eurozone external balance. And that has continued, and I'm going to discuss that further, because it's a very important part of the global process, and it will fit in with what I think is going to happen to China, which I will talk about in a little while. But remember, real domestic demand, real domestic absorption, the spending by people in the economy in the Eurozone, the thing that actually determines how well off people feel, which is what they are able to buy, is 4% below the starting point. In some of the crisis-hit economies, real domestic absorption has collapsed to a quite astonishing degree. In Greece, it's collapsed by about, real domestic absorption, by about 35%, and in Spain, by about 15%, today even, relative to the pre-crisis levels. Okay, so what does this mean in terms of the simplest possible measure of standards of living? And I'm afraid, because of lack of time, trying to avoid undue complexity, I'm not going to go into the distribution of income in this crisis. So I'm just looking at real GDP. What does this mean in terms of real GDP per head, at purchasing power parity? So this is a measure of standard of living which is comparable since the crisis hit, including a plausible forecast for 2015. And I think this is really fascinating. It brings out many, many interesting features of what's happened since the crisis. So of the six economies I've shown here, France, Germany, Italy, the UK, US, and Spain, only three are expected to have a higher GDP per head in 2015 than they had in 2007, 8 years earlier. Those are the US, UK, the US, and Germany in ascending order. Again, this underlines the relative success of Germany compared to all the other big economies during this crisis, for reasons we can go into, but it's a very important feature, I think, of German politics. Domestically, the Germans don't understand why anybody else thinks they're in a crisis. Perfectly understandable, given what's happened to them. US, again, the pattern is very, very similar to what I showed earlier, but because the US has a relatively dynamic demography by the standards of the developed world, GDP per head has been growing really very slowly over this period. It's risen by about, over the entire period from 2007, real GDP per head, that is over 8 years, has grown by 4%. For 8 years, for US real GDP per head to grow at 4% is astonishingly slow. It really has no previous period. In the UK, it's grown by 2%. In France, it's been completely stagnant for now for 4 years. So it's not very difficult to understand why the French feel they are in a malaise. Spain is beginning to have a recovery. The recovery is much vaunted, but GDP per head is still about 8% below the pre-crisis level, and Italy is showing no recovery. It is important, I just thought I'd throw in the point, Italy's real GDP per head is essentially the same as it was 20 years ago. Italy has ceased to grow. And that's a very, very important point. There was a modest growth before the crisis, but it's all been lost. So in terms of the standard of living, real GDP per head, the only developed country that is in reasonable shape of these big countries, Japan, by the way, will be much the same, sort of in between France and Spain, slightly better. The only one that looks at all comfortable is Germany. I thought I'd throw this in because one of the things I do, since I'm British and I'm obviously interested in the British debate, and most of you here probably never think about Britain at all, except as a very small offshore island. I think some of the historical experience has been fascinating. And so one of the most remarkable things about this crisis, which is one of the reasons I do not share the general admiration for by the electorate even, of the British government's macroeconomic and policy performance, is that our crisis recovery, post-crisis recovery, which I've just shown you, though better than that of many other developed countries, is vastly worse than it was in the 30s. Vastly worse. So now, our experience in the 30s was much better than that of America or Germany. That's famous. We can spend a long time, if you want, talking about why that was, but it's very important that that was the case. I mean, the most important reason for that was that in the end they followed Keynes' advice and went off gold. But in the 30s, after the first 3 years of the crisis, that's 32, you can see, and 33, we had a really strong recovery. Really, really strong recovery. And we've experienced nothing like that this time. In the UK case, we know that almost certainly that this is the worst recovery from any recession in the last 200 years. I mean, this is really, obviously, the numbers for GDP in the 19th century are invented. It's very difficult to be sure, but certainly on everything we know, this is appalling. And there's something else which is even worse, which I'm going to come to in a moment. In fact, I'm going to come to it here. As I've told you, an important feature of the crisis is this collapse in potential growth. The post-crisis collapse in potential growth. Part of this is demography. The baby boomers, and every country had a baby boomer after the war, the Second World War. I was part of the baby boom. I was born in 1946, and like many people, because my parents said to themselves, we've survived the war. How did we manage this? Let's have a child. And that's what happened all over the developed world. That's why there was a baby boom. And that went on for about 10 years. The US baby boom was particularly large. Nothing exceptional. So if you do the arithmetic, do the maths, as you would say here, or the math, I think, you will work out that all these people are now retiring. So there is a demographic reason. But it's not just about demography. There is a marked collapse in productivity growth. Now, I've taken this chart, which from Jason Furman at the Council of Economic Advisers. I could have shown you many other charts which all show you the same thing. It's, of course, it aggregates the whole 50 to 2007 period, so it exaggerates the productivity growth pre-crisis. Nonetheless, if you took shorter periods, I promise the same will be shown, which is productivity growth between 2010 and 2014 has been incredibly low, and in the UK and Italy, it's been zero. Japan, France, and the US, extremely low. What does that mean? Well, if this continues, it means, given the demography, the potential growth of the developed world is at worst in Europe about 1%. The potential growth rate is about 1%. And in the US, if you're very lucky, it's close to 2. Very lucky, it's close to 2. And that's a very important for the future. It affects future fiscal situation and everything else. And of the two effects, demography and the decline in productivity growth, the latter is the more important in actual numerical terms and the more worrying. As far as we know, now here we really are guessing, the UK, which has actually had zero productivity growth now for 7 years, has not had that experience in the last couple of hundred years since the Industrial Revolution. Now, we can't be sure. Nobody knows too well what happened in the first half of the 19th century. But certainly, this very long period of no zero productivity growth is remarkable. And it's the most important, in my view, of the long-term shadows on the developed world. Now, so that's my coverage of very briefly updated of what's happened to the developed world and what I think are the biggest economic issues. There are many others that that development shows. Now, the second thing I want to turn to, and this really is an update and a shift in focus. If I were writing the book now, I would have much more about this than I have, is what's happened to the emerging economies. And I think this chart, again, which I've taken from the IMF, brings out the point very, very clearly. These are successive growth forecasts from the IMF. Now, I find this way of presenting things is much more interesting than the forecasts themselves. The forecasts are, of course, always wrong. That's true. Forecasts exist to be wrong. That's self-evident. You all know that. But the development of forecasts over time shows how the consensus is changing. And the remarkable thing is that the successive consensus is that while the advanced economy potential growth is clearly slowing from the crisis, post-crisis onwards, the slowdown in absolute terms in the emerging economies is much bigger, from a close to 7% growth to just 5% growth. Since population growth in the emerging world as a whole, probably as a whole, is 1.5-2% or so, I don't know the exact figure, the decline in the rate of growth of GDP per head is much bigger than these figures show. On these estimates, the rate of growth of GDP per head in the emerging world is now expected to be not much more than half of what was expected 5 years ago. So this is a very significant deterioration in expectations for the economic performance that affects 85% of humanity. So this is a really, really big deal. So what's going on there and how does it relate to the crisis? I think that's a very complicated question, which I only touch on in this chapter and possibly a new book. There are clearly cyclical factors. There are the reversal of post-crisis fiscal boosts, a lot of important emerging economies. And China was just the most significant, but India, Brazil, Russia, pursued quite expansionary fiscal policies immediately after the crisis to get through the crisis. There's been the end of China's post-crisis property boom and the move into the new normal, and associated with the latter, a massive downswing in commodity prices. I'm not going to show the evidence for this, but I think most of you know that this has happened, and it's been particularly dramatic for producers of industrial raw materials. Since the bulk of emerging economies in number, though less so in terms of population weighted, but in number, live in economies which are commodity exporters, that has a very dramatic effect on the terms of trade and growth rates, therefore, resources, investment, and so forth, of the emerging world as a whole. It's been very dramatic effects on Latin America. I won't be able to go into that anymore. And also Africa, large parts of sub-Saharan Africa, and of course the oil producers. You know that. So these are cyclical stroke structural. I think they're stroke structural because I think the commodity super cycle has moved into a different phase on a semi-permanent basis. Structural. The long-term slowdown in the growth of high-income economies and the long-term slowdown in the growth of consumption in high-income economies because, to put it bluntly, the consumers, households of the developed world are, with one or two exceptions, hopelessly over-leveraged and therefore cannot restart the sort of credit boom we saw in the run-up to the crisis, or if they can, only relatively briefly. This means a permanent slowdown in demand for the consumers on whom export-oriented emerging countries depended, particularly the US, but also, of course, in Europe. So that's a fundamental structural shift. There's been the post-crisis rebalancing of high-income economies. In general, most developed countries, and that was shown actually in the charts earlier on the US and Eurozone, have reduced their current account deficits and or massively increased their current account surpluses. And that, of course, by definition, has pushed emerging economies into deficit. And the terms of trade shift has reinforced that, and that's made them substantially more financially vulnerable. There is a large structural slowdown in China, and there's been a long period of lagging structural reform. So the slowdown in the emerging world is a really big deal. I think it's probably long term. And if I were writing the book again, though I have a discussion of it, I think I would write much more about it. I thought I'd take the opportunity, though this is not in my chapter, to say a little bit, just a little bit, about what I think is going on, or the core of what I think is going on. My views are somewhat controversial, I know, but of course I think they're right, to the most important economy in the world, China, right? From this point of view, and perhaps all points of view, the economy that's generated most of the demand growth, indeed most of the growth in the economy, the world economy, for at least 10 years. So the first point to make is, from a demand point of view, I'm going to come to the supply in a minute, what has been driving China's growth over the last 15 years and what has changed? And if you look at it, it's a fascinating pattern. So the black line shows, and by the way, this comes with all the usual qualifications about the quality of Chinese GDP statistic, blah, 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 and we can have a long discussion about that. But my view on this is, let's assume the GDP statistics are all somewhat wrong. Everybody's are wrong, and these are probably more wrong than most for reasons which I think are reasonably obvious. But I don't see any reason why the degree to which they're wrong should have changed over time. So if you want to do an adjustment for everything for level, you can do that. But I think it doesn't really affect the changes I've shown here. So up to 2007, China had a staggering growth performance, which peaked at 14% in 2007. So this was one of the most sensational booms in the history of the world. It started at nearly 9% and it ended at 14%. This was driven largely by three factors: an improvement in growth of consumption, a very rapid growth of investment, and in the last several years, a huge increase in the current account surplus, the trade surplus. Then the crisis hit, and as you can see from the blue blocks, this trade surplus growth reversed. This is, if you look at the blue blocks between 2007 and 2009, it's absolutely staggering how big the external rebalancing in China was. I'm going to show that in another chart. It's an absolutely astonishing picture for such a gigantic economy. The only other countries that have had comparable rebalancing over a short period were crisis-hit countries like Spain or Greece. So they had this massive reversal. Growth declined to 9%, which still was incredibly fast. So how did China manage that despite this incredible shift in the current account external balance, which is a demand shift? It's a reduction in net external demand. And the way they did this is seen in the green block. In 2009 and 2010, fueled by credit, China promoted, I think, must certainly be the biggest construction boom in ever. They went into an absolutely colossal property boom, which created, associated with it, immense expansion in debt. The aggregate debt to GDP ratio doubled, increased by 100 percentage points in 3 years. So just enormous expansion. These are all China's data. And then the new government came into power and said, we've had enough of that, we're going to stop this, and they slowed the investment rate. And you can see that because the investment rate slowed, the economy slowed, and so did the consumption growth, because the economy is growing more slowly, so household disposable income is growing more slowly, and consumption grew. And the two things together then lowered the growth rate to about 7%, which is where it's been over the last 3 years. And this is what the Chinese call the new normal. And if you look at that on its own, it looks perfect. It looks as though China has pulled off a miraculous adjustment to the new normal. Okay, there's a problem with this, however, which is what I want to emphasize in thinking about the future of the world economy with this Chinese adjustment. So this looks at the same thing, but in terms of shares of spending in China's GDP, or demand for China's product, if you like, over the same period, going up to 2014, 2015, for obvious reasons, is not available. This chart shows two things which I think really matter. The first is this massive expansion and then contraction of the external balance in the 2000s, up to a peak of 9% of GDP. China, there was this huge economy with a current account surplus of about 10% of GDP and net exports of 9% of GDP back in 2007, and the contraction. And the second thing that comes out of this is if you look at the blue block, which is the investment share in GDP, is that as the net exports contracted, it was gross investment, which compensated. So it was gross investment that compensated. So China, which was already investing about 40% of GDP in 2006-07, peaked at investment of 47% of GDP. So far as I know, no large economy has ever invested anything close to that in world history. So they were investing about 47% of GDP. Now the problem with that is fairly simple. With that rate of investment and with the growth rate declining to 7%, two things happen, which are more or less the same thing. What the economists call the incremental capital output ratio, which is the amount of growth you're getting per unit of investment, soars. In fact, it reaches now about 8. It's about 7. Historically, the Chinese incremental capital rate ratio was 4. It's now about 7. So this is another way of thinking about it, is the marginal return on investment is collapsing. And the second thing that is happening, that with that investment rate and with that growth rate, I discussed that in another paper, the capital output ratio in China is on an explosive path. And it is now already higher than the US, and in a year or two, it will be higher than Japan. So it is an immensely capital-intensive economy with declining productivity of capital, or put it another way, it's not getting much growth given this staggering investment. Just let me put this in context. 46% of GDP compares with investment in the US or UK, which are too low, at about 16 or 17%. So it is an immense investment push. And all the growth rate in China, and this is the last chart, is being driven by this immense investment effort. Because the other thing that has been happening, which is the single most worrying thing, I'm sure, for Chinese policymakers, is that total factor productivity growth has disappeared. They had an incredibly strong growth of total factor productivity up till about 2007, improvements in efficiency in the use of resources, and over the last 3-4 years, that's gone away. It's not quite clear why, but it's clear that it's gone away. And the growth is being driven by this investment boom with declining investment returns. And that's why, in and on of itself, I think it's inevitable that the growth rate will tend to decline, simply because it's being driven by an investment effort which needs continually to increase to generate the same growth, but it's not increasing anymore. The investment rate, as you will have seen in the previous chart, is roughly a constant share of GDP now. So for that reason alone, the growth rate will tend to slow. Now, what's the big risk here? The big risk here, and I could tell this story in debt terms as well, because there's a debt overhang, there are lots of investors that have borrowed a lot of money to make this incredible investment effort. But you can think of it in a very, very simple way. If you're finding that the marginal return on your investment has fallen to zero or negative, which I think is almost certainly the case at the margin, and the margin is probably a large chunk of investment, if the economy is expected to grow far more slowly, so you can't be confident that you're ever going to recoup that, the rational thing to do for pretty well every investor in this situation is to postpone investment. That's what you would normally expect to happen in a period like that, and to some degree that's clearly happening. If the Chinese investors start postponing investment to a significant degree, they will be withdrawing a large chunk of what generates half of the demand in the economy. And the economy moves into recession. And that's the knife edge on which they are. They need investment growth to slow, because they're wasting a hell of a lot of capital. But if investment growth starts slowing seriously, then the growth rate of the economy itself will collapse. And that is basically what's been happening to Japan in the last 25 years. I could discuss that at length. So they have a knife-edge adjustment path, and what makes it much worse is if growth really does slow significantly, the debt problems of over-indebted businesses will get vastly worse, and they will start having to reconstruct the financial sector in a big way. So my view, and I suspect that in privately, the recent policy behavior of the Chinese government suggests they share this view, at least at the technical level, is that growth is much, much more fragile than most people think, and it could slow very dramatically. If you want to think about it another way, why will the Chinese ever build another steel mill? And the answer is, since they already have the capacity to produce 700 million tons a year, they never will. And the same applies to car plants and a lot of other things. So they've got a restructuring to do. I can think they can handle it, but the need is to dramatically shift the sources of demand towards public and private consumption. In the short run, I don't think they can do it through private consumption, so it will have to be public consumption. And that means a completely different role for government in Chinese economy from the one we've seen in the last 25 years. Okay, that's all taken much too long, so I'm now going to go through the last, I've actually given you most of what I have to tell you about what's happened. I'm going to deal with some policy issues, and then I'll do my lessons and fears, and that's very quick. So policies. When we look at how we got here and how we handled this crisis, which has had this terribly long shadow, as I've indicated, the basic macro response was characterized by reliance on expansionary monetary policy and a very early turn to fiscal austerity. That basically started in 2010, 11, 12. And an important question is, did that work? And I would argue that in the case of the developed world, it has had one particularly important problem, and it links with the productivity growth conundrum, which I show you, which is, and I'll give you an indication of this, the failure to sustain investment across the developed world. And that was a pronounced failure of macro and economic policy. The sheer scale of the shortfall in demand, which I've already shown you, basically persuaded investors in the developed world to stop investment. That affected productivity growth, and that in turn affected growth, and therefore validated the shortfalls in investment. And I'm going to focus in particular, because it was a voluntary decision, the UK experience, which suggests that this argument for austerity was not very strong, and though implementation was flexible, it still imposed very substantial costs. So I think it is even more clear now than I thought when I wrote the book that the macroeconomic response was far from ideal, inadequate to sustain demand after the crisis. Policy was not used to the full. And this is very consistent with the view of another more recent book on the crisis, which is Barry Eichengreen's comparison of what was done in the 30s and what was done now. And his major conclusion in that book was that though we did much better in the 30s, we didn't do better enough. And that's basically what I'm saying. The monetary expansion has been also very highly criticized, and it remains highly criticized, but simply, in my view, given what happened to demand and given what happened to fiscal policy, there was never really a choice. There was nothing else they could do. So I just wanted to show you, it follows up from the previous chart that I gave you, what happened to the contribution of capital investment to annual growth of labor productivity in the crisis compared with the very long period before the crisis. Now, this is actually quite an interesting and complicated story, so I'm not going to go through all of it. But the basic story, the remarkable exception is Italy, which is a puzzle to me, and France, is that in the UK, Germany, Japan, and the US, investment fell so much that it ceased to make any serious contribution to productivity growth. I was not aware until I saw this chart just how big the investment collapse in the US was and how important that's been in terms of productivity. So investment collapse has had a very big effect on the productivity shortfall, which we've seen in this decline in potential output. So the question then is, could we have done better, looking back on this, in terms of demand management? It's just the issue I'm going to focus on. There are many others. Now, it was thought by many in 2010, you will remember this, and it emerged in the G20 meeting in June in Ottawa, that the large post-crisis fiscal deficits would lead to fiscal crises. And that was when the G20 basically decided to move to austerity. I didn't think at this stage that this was at all a likely risk. I thought we were making the mistake the Japanese had made in 96, 97. But anyway, the UK government provided a nice test case of this, because it introduced a plan for a massive fiscal tightening in June 2010. And it was a voluntary one, and it was different from the US in that the large fiscal tightening was imposed by the sequestration process. So it was not a result of an agreement by the administration. It was a result of a breakdown of coordination between the administration and Congress. So what lessons can we draw from the UK experience? And the UK experience is really very fascinating. And it's slightly double-edged for me, but I think it tells you the main story. So back in June 2010, the British government said, we have this terrible fiscal crisis. We have to eliminate our structural or cyclically adjusted fiscal deficit over a period of 5 years. So they said, at that stage, they thought the fiscal deficit, structural fiscal deficit, was about 7.5% of GDP, and they said they would eliminate it in 5 years, which is a massive fiscal contraction for a country which at that stage was actually under no market pressure. And the government announced that this was essential. If it didn't, we would become Greece. I'm not making it up. That's what they said. And they started like that for a year. And then, fortunately, they stopped because the economy actually stopped growing altogether in the first 2 years of this government. And the fiscal adjustment, as we can see, the blue line shows what they now expect, or actually expected in March, they've slightly revised it since, is they ended up with a fiscal contraction which was roughly half of what they planned. And that was a very sensible adjustment. So to their credit, the fiscal adjustment turned out to be substantially less than they promised, but initially it was very substantial, and initially the economy stopped growing. They did a whole host of other things. The fiscal deficit, therefore, and this is an important point, has remained very, very substantial throughout, and the British government now promises to do what it condemned the previous government, the Labour government, for promising to do, which is to eliminate the fiscal deficit over a decade, which I think is closer to being sane than what they forecast. So that was sensible. The interesting thing, though, to ask is whether at any stage in this process of running much larger fiscal deficits than they promised, were they subject to any severe constraints from the bond market. So I've just put a very simple chart on what's happened to long-term UK government 10-year gilts, which are 10-year bonds. I could put index-linked bonds or anything else over this period, the last 20 years. And you can see that during the crisis period, essentially UK long-term gilts have oscillated between 1.5% and 3%, and they're now 2%. So it is absolutely clear, it seems to me, just as I thought, and as has now become, I think, completely obvious, is that huge fiscal deficits are completely manageable in the post-crisis situation, at least for large governments borrowing in their own currency with their own central bank, and the UK government's hysteria about the possibility of becoming Greece was absurd. Finally, on this issue, let me just look at what's happened to monetary policy, because it's relevant to the debate we're seeing in the US now. So this is what's happened to central bank intervention rates. It's an update of what I gave last year over the last 20 years. And as I pointed out then, every central bank in the developed world has found itself driven to near zero rates. In fact, I like to point out that the UK on a half a point is the highest in the developed world, which is a fairly surreal statement. A very important part of understanding this monetary policy response can be gained by looking at what happened to the Eurozone, which is the green line. Back in 2011, the ECB, simply hating being on 1%, decided to raise rates to 1.5%. The economy tanked, they had a major crisis, and they then started slashing extremely rapidly, and despite their best efforts to raise rates, they ended up at zero. And this is relevant, I think, to the debate, and it's what I comment on this morning, in the US today. You may think you want to raise rates, but it won't work if the economy won't support it. And in my view, none of our economies is yet in a shape to support rates much above zero. And that will be a really big test. And that's, of course, linked with the immense damage done by the crisis, the debt overhang, and all the other problems associated with it. By the way, Andy Haldane, a friend of mine who works at the Bank of England, has done an immense amount of research. He has the resources of the Bank of England and has discovered, and that raises lots of interesting questions, that long-term interest rates today seem to be lower than they've ever been in the entire 5,000 history of humanity. And for some, in some way, he's discovered somebody, I don't know who the somebody is, who has worked out from the wonderful records they kept what the interest rates used to be in Babylon, 3000 BC. So there is a chart, which is in his speech, which I cite this morning, which shows interest rates for the last 5,000 years, and they have never been lower. They've never been as low as this. In the UK case, the half a point we see is a quarter of the lowest base rate or bank rate the Bank of England has ever operated in 300 years. And in addition, there has been this staggering expansion of the balance sheets of the central banks, and it isn't over. And that's again very important in understanding the Fed situation, because the Bank of Japan and the ECB, which is the green line, you can see it beginning to pick up, are engaged in massive monetary expansion right now, and that's one reason why the dollar is so strong and is likely to remain strong, and that also is going to constrain the Fed's ability to raise rates. So in addition to having incredibly expansionary monetary policy, incredibly low interest rates, we have these huge expansions of balance sheets and very, very weak growth. And that remains the fundamental fact about the economy. Unprecedentedly expansionary monetary policy with very, very weak growth. Now, there have been many objections to the easy money policy, that it would lead to high inflation, that it would create ultra-low long-term interest rates, which are very damaging for resource allocation, and that it worsens distribution of income. The first has turned out to be completely wrong. I think it's pretty clear by now that's wrong. The second is very difficult to argue because I think it's increasingly obvious that these very low real rates are equilibrium rates in our very strange economy. I think it is true that they worsen distribution of income, but the alternatives would have been, in my view, a much deeper recession, and that would be even worse for most people. So the monetary policies were inescapable, though they were, I think, second best. We should have used fiscal policy more aggressively, and we should have restructured debt much more aggressively. I discussed that in my chapter, but I don't have time to discuss it now. The question is, could we have pursued more effective monetary policy, given that we didn't have the fiscal policy route? And here you get into some really unconventional areas, which I've increasingly come to believe we are going to have to think about. One is actually raising the inflation target. So giving monetary policy more room before it gets close to the zero bound. The second, to have a target for the level of nominal GDP. And if we had a target for the level of nominal GDP, it will be clear that there should be no question of raising rates now. And of course, there's the extreme possibility, which I just mentioned here, which is if nothing else works, helicopter money. In other words, give every citizen of a country an account at the central bank and put money in it, and then let them spend it. Okay, so that we could be much more radical than we have been, and in the next crisis, I sort of suspect we will be. So finally, lessons and fears. So the first lesson is that recoveries ultimately happen. We're having very weak recoveries, as I've shown you, but the long-run consequence of this crisis now look really, really damaging, and they're going to make policy options very difficult for the developed world for a very long time. These long-run costs are so high because the policy response was inadequate. And this is not 2020 hindsight for me, because I've been arguing this for 5 years. Fiscal austerity was premature. Monetary policy was not successful in adequately offsetting it. It was insufficiently expansionary, not too expansionary. And the reconstruction of debt and of the financial sector was too slow. We need to plan for the next crisis, I'm afraid, because this financial sector that we have today will give us another one. And it might not be that far in the future. The responses, it's now clear, we need to plan for this, need to include swifter reconstruction of finance and debt, and even more unconventional monetary support of the economy. Unfortunately, in most countries, and this is particularly true in the US, it will be more difficult to pursue those policies next time than last time because of changes in the law which constrain the ability of the Fed to operate and changes in attitudes to fiscal policy. Fourth point, the Eurozone is not fixed. The Union is not yet credibly irrevocable. Democratic legitimacy has been eroded. I haven't spent time talking about the Eurozone crisis and how it was resolved and to the extent to which it's resolved. And the reason for that is I'm giving another seminar next month and I want you all to come. Finally, fears. I said this would be beep. My first fear, and I think this is the fundamental issue, is what Larry Summers calls secular stagnation. I call it excessive debt dependency. Generating demand in line with potential output over a long period seems to require large buildups of debt somewhere in the global system. So after it was the developed world that stopped building up debt, it was China, and China is now in difficulty as a result. Getting growth without massive build-ups in debt is an essential condition for stability in the system. This is partly because of the distribution of income and spending across the world and the nature of the distribution of income and spending across the world, particularly the distribution of income away from households towards profits, has, I think, worldwide, therefore towards saving, made it much more difficult to manage aggregate demand at the world level. Remember that Keynes was particularly concerned about aggregate demand at the world level. That's what his contributions to Bretton Woods were all about. These are fundamental debates we're having. And it is also, of course, partly because our monetary system, is inherently debt dependent. The basic way we develop, expand our money supply in our economy is by expanding the debts due to and owed by our banking sector. So the monetary system, as Friedman often argued, is inherently fragile. Making our economies less debt dependent, an important theme of my book, remains very important. Or having debt contracts, which are far easier to renegotiate in crisis situations. This is an Atif Mian and Amir Sufi point, is very, very important. So that's my first fear, debt dependency. The second fear is that the Eurozone monetary system continues to work very poorly. It cannot be allowed to collapse, and new crises will emerge, in my view. The third fear is that we're getting, as a result of the failure of our political elites, a very, very clear anti-elite movement across the entire Western world. And I think it's shown very clearly in the what's going on in American politics. It's very clear in British politics with the possible election of a man called Jeremy Corbyn, an extreme left winger to the leadership of the Labour Party. You can see it clearly in French politics with the strength of the Front National. You can see it in Spanish politics and Greek politics. In fact, the only country, and of course in Italian politics, though it's contained at the moment, the one country where you're really not seeing this at all, remarkably and fascinatingly, but it's linked to what I said earlier, is Germany. But what we are seeing is raging populism of the left and right. I predicted that that will be a consequence of our failure to deal with the crisis, and it's clearly happening, and we're not through this stage. And for that reason as well, and also what is now happening in China, I think the durability of contemporary globalized capitalism cannot be taken for granted. So I know I've gone on a bit longer than I hoped, but I hope I've given you a useful overview, if cursory in some ways, of how I think things have developed and what we should think about what has happened. And when we look back at this, I think, immense economic shock that the crisis is. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Martin, for a fantastically substantive and detailed engagement on a critical set of issues. I always feel when you come that you are an economist's economist, and you never make a point without demonstrating it with data in a very powerful way. We have with us today in this audience extraordinary experts on the global economy, Indonesia, Japan, Europe, Latin America. So I'm loath to start with a question, but let me ask you to comment on one thing and then open it up to the real experts we have in the room. I think that from the beginning of the crisis, you were arguing that the austerity measures were wrong-headed. And I just wonder if you would speculate for us for a moment on the counterfactual. If the measures that you were arguing earlier had been taken along the way, what you think would be the difference today?
Now, that's a very, an extremely good question. And the details of the counterfactual are very important. So I think the fundamental point I would make, and I did make, so it's not ex post, is that in the immediate aftermath of the crisis, so I won't talk about all the mistakes that were made in the run-up to the crisis. That's now a very, very long time ago, and I write about that at great length in my book, and so let's treat that as history, though it's part of the lessons, because we would like to avoid a repeat, and I don't think we have avoided a repeat. We have not created the conditions that will avoid a repeat. But the my main point in 2009, 10, 11, and 12 is we'd experienced a dramatic shock to confidence and a dramatic shock to the financial sector and a large shock to asset prices, particularly the most important ones against which most people borrow, namely property prices. So we had a property-related debt crisis in a range of very important economies, of which the US was the most significant, but it wasn't the only one. Spain should not be underestimated in its terms of its impact on the world. So we had a financial sector problem, an asset market problem, a deleveraging problem, and as a result of deleveraging started once, we had a chronic deficiency of demand in the private sector as a whole. In past, there was then a lot of literature that emerged. I won't suggest the names. These are all discussed in my first, in my book itself, about expansionary austerity. The argument being, we've got this fiscal crisis, huge fiscal deficits as a result of this, and that is indeed the consequence of a crisis, as Ken Rogoff and Carmen Reinhart pointed out in their great book. So we've got this terrible fiscal problem. The right thing to do is get rid of that by cutting spending, and this will be expansionary. My argument, and this is very important in understanding the nature of that debate and what should have been done, my argument throughout was, and I think after a few years, people generally accepted this, I'm not saying because of me, by the way, many others made the argument, that those, the people who'd look back on expansionary austerity experiences, of which the most important were Canada in the mid-90s and the Scandinavians, these were the most important developed country examples, had ignored the extent to which, because these were very small economies, they're small economies, in a world which was growing rather dynamically, remember the 90s were the 90s of the great US boom, strong growth in Europe too, the German reunification boom and so forth, they didn't ignore the extent to which these countries were able to grow by expanding their exports, which they did. That was a very large part of why you could combine contractionary fiscal policy with expansionary, an expansionary economy. But if you got half the world in recession, the export-led growth model wouldn't work very well, though, in fact, the Europeans ended up trying it, because there wasn't any demand anywhere in the system. China was doing wonderfully, but it wasn't enough to support the entire world. So it was essential to sustain demand in the developed world. To do that, and I thought that as soon as we hit the zero bound, we would find that monetary policy would work, but it wouldn't work that well. In fact, I have to admit that the policies they pursued worked a little bit better than I expected. But it didn't work that well, and that's clear from what we see. So what needed to be done? And I feared that if we allowed spending to collapse and the recession to be deep and the growth to be very slow, investment would indeed slow dramatically, productivity growth would slow, and the economy would not recover quickly. And you get into a cycle in which you expect low growth, you invest on the basis of low growth, people lose jobs and disappear from the labor market altogether, you've just got permanent losses. And that's very clear, the hysteresis effect, in the US labor market. So what did you need to do? You had to sustain demand using both fiscal and monetary policy wherever you could until the economy had really reignited, and you had to restructure the financial sector as quickly as possible so that it would be able to function again and get rid of as much debt as possible so households could continue household balance sheets were restored as quickly as possible. I would say economies varied in the extent to which they did this. The US was relatively good on the financial sector. It did much better, more quickly than anybody else. It was a mess on restructuring the household debt, but there was a lot of bankruptcy, which was brutal, but it sort of helped. Europe was very, very slow in all these respects, and that's why the recovery was so slow. The UK was in between. But looking back on it, it seems to me clear that I think the UK had no reason to raise taxes. They had a huge tax hike in the first year of 2010. That slowed growth, I think, sharply, and it coincided with the Eurozone slowdown, so it just smashed confidence in the economy for 2 or 3 years. The recovery then came 2 or 3 years later, and there were huge losses. The US ditto, I think, could have been much stronger if the administration had got its demand, had got another round of stimulus. I think the stimulus clearly worked, and the and if the sequester had been avoided, I think it would could have perhaps grown at 3% for several years. I think that would have made a lot of difference. And finally, the problem in the Eurozone is they never thought of it as an aggregate demand problem. What they thought of it is a set of national problems. There was no EU-type strategy to deal with this other than de facto contraction in the crisis-hit countries and massive shifts into export, which I will show in the other chart. So I think it would, these sorts of policies could have operated, would have been effective, and would have caused no fiscal crisis whatsoever. And I think the subsequent experience supports this. I understand that everything I've said is wildly controversial, and it will probably never be agreed by economists in the next 100 years, because we're still debating the 30s. But I was very pleased to see that Barry, whom I take very seriously, is a very sober, if somewhat liberal economist, very sober and very distinguished economic historian, subsequently came to the same view and explained it in great detail in his new book. So very briefly, you think not briefly, I never do briefly, very briefly, that's the best answer I can give you to this incredibly important and difficult question.
Thank you very much. Let's open it up, and may I invite folks who ask a question to possibly come up here quickly. We'll start over here, and then I see you, sir, have a bad foot. We'll let you speak from there. But please come up here if you would. And if you could identify yourself.
Wanda Lopus, and I would like to thank you very much for this very insightful presentation, especially not being an expert, but a mere student of learning more about economy. So my question comes from the business perspective. You argued and presented the collapse of productivity. In business, these days, we are talking about super productivity in digital economy. Actually, the digital economy causes the jobless growth, as we are talking in business, because of robots, because of incredible power of the machines that are applied. So could you please reconcile that macroeconomic view with what in business we are very fearful about, which is what happens to those people who did not get enough of the digital skills to be part of this growing economy, the digital economy that causes digital divide? Thank you.
That's an absolutely wonderful question. Unfortunately, there is no good answer which takes less than 15 minutes. So the first thing I will do is say that there was an issue of foreign affairs. Go figure, I don't know. Perhaps because Gideon Rose is the editor. Which came out, I think, in June on the question of the robotic economy. And the only reason I refer to it is that it has an absolutely brilliant article on the question that you raise by me. It has an article by me on the question you raise, which is, and my argument, by the way, which is not, in summary, which is not unique, which is not mine, I've stolen it, as all good journalists have, from other and better informed people, is that the new technology is dramatically overhyped. But it is clear that we are being told two things. The data are telling us very clearly that underlying trend productivity growth in our economy has been on somewhat of a decline for at least since the early 2000s, okay? And that it collapsed after the crisis. And the business literature and the technology literature are telling us that we're in the midst of the most dramatic technological revolution ever. You know, this is a complete transformation of the world. And clearly, we would like to reconcile these two statements. The statisticians are not insane. They work very, very hard to try and compute what they can. And they are aware of this problem. On the other hand, business people state this very consistently, and clearly we are all aware, I'm not completely balmy, that we are enjoying opportunities through the internet in particular, through our clever little devices, which we've never enjoyed before. So how do we explain this? And I think it's a genuine and important puzzle because it bears on where our future grows. So let me just put forward a number of possibilities. One possibility, which the technological optimists believe in, is that we are mismeasuring GDP dramatically. And that very important parts of consumer welfare are no longer appear in GDP statistics. And there are clearly important examples of that, because very valuable services are provided to a significant extent free, like Google search, okay? And so there is unmeasured GDP, or at least unmeasured consumer value, which is close to GDP. My argument against that is that I think this is true, but if you think carefully about past technological developments over the last 200 years, previous technological developments also generated enormous increases in welfare, at least, and in business models going with that, much of which was unrecorded for one reason or another. The most interesting example of that, though it's directly relevant to other aspects of the technology revolution which are not recorded, is the revolution in household productivity, which I actually think was the most important revolution in productivity of the last century, which went along with the invention of the electric light, the gas cooker, running water, and every machine that we rely upon, dishwashers and washing machines and vacuum cleaners and so forth. So that 100 years ago, it took at least one person, obviously, as a matter of fact, usually a woman, and quite often two or three people, working 7 or 8 hours a day to keep a house running. Today, thank God, this can be done in an hour or two a week. Well, I believe it's like cooking, which is more problematic, but then we go out for that. So we've had a complete productivity revolution in the household. Massive improvement in welfare, and it's one of the reasons that the female entry in the labor force was so dramatic. I would argue that nothing that the iPad or all the other stuff has done begins to compare with the welfare and even GDP impact of that, because it has immensely expanded our labor force. And I can go through many other examples. Think about electric light, the productivity implications of electric light. Just think about winter without electric light. So I think the first thing is that it's overhyped. People forget the technological revolutions of the past. The second thing that I think is true is that it's possible that we are getting technological changes which dramatically shift the labor force, because they are clearly shifting the labor force, without actually increasing aggregate output in any measurable way, in which case we're getting the worst of both worlds. So it is perfectly possible that is what is happening. The final point I would make is whatever the story about this is, it cannot explain the fact that we measure that before the crisis, productivity growth was level A, and after the crisis, it's level half A or a quarter A. Nothing happened in the digital economy in 2008 and 9 and 10 to explain that. The only thing that happened was the financial crisis. So it's pretty clear that financial crisis must be the proximate cause of that phenomenon. Even if the truth is, if we measure productivity properly, it was much faster before and is faster afterwards. But the change, we must be measuring something genuine, it seems to me. There's something else going on. But the final point I would make is a general point about understanding productivity. And this is a long-term process. It's not related to this thing. But it seems to me very interesting and important. The general story of development is this. There are qualifications to what I'm going to say, but the general story is that sectors with very, very fast growth of productivity are sectors whose employment share falls, for pretty obvious reasons, and indeed whose GDP share also normally tends to fall. Unless demand growth is very, very dramatic, in current prices, and we measure GDP cumulatively with chain indices, so we change the weights to measure current prices. In current prices, the sectors with really fast falling prices because of rapid growth of productivity, unless demand explodes, shrink as a share of GDP. It happened to agriculture, it's happening to manufacturing, and it's going to happen to all the sectors of services where digital economy really works. So I expect the digital economy to become really small because it's all so cheap. And what do we end up with? We end up with the services which are really difficult to digitize. What's the biggest sector of our economy now? The biggest single sector by far, healthcare. It's really hard to change. We may change. Maybe we'll have robotic doctors which will do everything. Maybe that's what's going to happen. But so far, we don't see any sign of it at all. It's more and more labor-intensive. Looking after children, looking after old people. These are the sectors that have become the bigger and bigger share of our economy. And by definition, they are the biggest share of our economy because there isn't much productivity growth there. And that's where we'll end up. So in the long run, I think, it is plausible we'll end up with an economy, even if we're incredibly successful, where there's no more productivity growth. So that may be part of what's going on. That doesn't explain the shift that between the pre-crisis and post, but it might explain the long-term decline. The fastest growth of productivity in our economy for the last 30, 40 years among major sectors has consistently, absolutely consistent, among major sectors, has been manufacturing. And the result is nobody's employed in manufacturing, and manufacturers share in GDP, not nobody, but it's 10-12% of the population. It used to be 30-40%. And that's where we're going. So that will be completely consistent with an absolute technological revolution and no measured effect, in the end, very little effect on GDP, because we end up with all this slow growth stuff. So that would support my first point, then, that maybe what we're going to see is the worst of both worlds. But we don't know, and it's a fascinating issue.
Well, let me say this is, if you're, indulge me, we'll eat into our mingling time to collect a couple of questions, because I see there are a few people. We'll want to come back to that one on the 19th of October, if I may. But let me collect a couple of questions for those who have a burning urge. You had raised your hand earlier, and if you could speak loudly, please.
Ah.
Oh,
okay. What have you done to your foot?
Thank you.
Thank you. Martin, as you know, the Queen famously asked a bunch of economists, why didn't any of you predict the crisis? Now, I'm going to be, if the Queen were here, I suspect she might well ask, the question, why didn't you economists buy and agree with Martin Wolf a long time earlier? I mean, what took you so long? And why do defunct economists remain defunct for so long? So part of the question is, how much of it is the kind of, if you like, the mainstream orthodoxy that dominated the economics profession, that, and how rapidly is it changing? What are your hopes, and what is the role of that ideology? Because the other is interest. There are two things, which, as you know, interest and ideology. So we know part of this answer to the ideology story. There was an orthodoxy of mainstream economics profession which believed in these things. What are the interests, you think, then? First is, you know, what is happening to the side? How quickly? What are the interests which are opposed to, which are for austerity, which oppose the kind of saner Martin Wolf response to saving the world?
Let me collect one or two other questions. I see two over here. Could I invite you to come up quickly? And I think the woman in front of you also. No? Okay, please.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Wolf. My name is Joy Ma. I'm a second year student at SIPA. So my question is about what you mentioned before. You said a cheap credit period would be expected in China. But what will be different this time? Do you see a greater potential for the private sector to have a better access to the credit? But also, at the same time, does it imply really letting the market to play a decisive role in the process of the reform? But also, at the same time, we can see just last month, in the last couple of months, we saw the equity market and a constant intervention from the government. Does it imply how serious they are about letting the market to play the decisive role? And let me put it in the other way, that would be how doable it is, considering there are obstacles and complexity in the existing group already. Thank you.
Thank you. Great question. I see two other gentlemen. Let's make these the last two questions.
Sure. I can't answer that in 2 minutes.
My name is Peter. I'm a second year student at SIPA. Earlier on, you talked about the need for the U.S. market to think about the long-term implications and prepare for the next wave of crisis. I completely agree with you. The geopolitical risk that has been coming from China and other emerging markets recently has caused serious shocks in the stock market. We saw the spillover effect recently when the stock market, for instance, dipped below 1,000 points in August and July. In your opinion, how resilient is the U.S. market against all these external shocks that are coming from the emerging markets? Is the recent boom and bust that we are currently experiencing the new normal? And if it is, what should we be prepared for?
Thank you. Last question.
My name is Jochen. I work in psychology, so I apologize for the lack of precision in my terminology, maybe. But I'd be curious if you could comment on how things such as, you said there's very low inflation and that fear did not materialize, but stock markets have really highly increased in their nominal value, at least over the past, let's say, 10 years, even regardless of the crisis. And so it seems that while maybe the real value of all the companies traded on at the stock market might not have gone up as much, there is at least the prices might be a little too high for their actual value. And I remember that someone from Germany, the retirement funds originally, I think, were just really this generational contract where people didn't have to worry about their retirement in looking at the stock market, whereas now the recommendation is for all the retirement to be somewhat covered by or to invest in stocks. And so to what extent might the reliance on the stock market for future economic welfare just be too much to then not allow for this kind of fluctuation variability in prices to actually lead to this overall fear of how people deal with that?
Thank you.
These are wonderful questions.
I think, could I invite...
How many seconds are you going to give me, Merit?
Well, you know, we've promised some mingled time with
okay,
you.
Okay, so I will really try, and I will be... What I'm going to say is unfair to the depth of the questions. So I apologize, and every one of them deserves at least 15 minutes, and unfortunately, I'm, by temperament, prone to giving 15 minutes, but I won't do it. So... What explains the response to the crisis? I think there are three factors, and I'm not very good at separating them. The first is the tyranny of the usual. The most difficult thing for a human to do, and I found it difficult, so very difficult, is to recognize that the world you thought you were in actually isn't the world you are in, and to change the way you think as a result. Now, of all economists there have ever been, the one who was best at that, and some would criticize him for that, was Keynes. And probably the one who was worst at that was Hayek. And the but I think that the first mistake was the tendency throughout to assume that the way you had thought about the world and the way you developed your thoughts about the world, including my own, because they changed, was still apposite in the very different world we were catapulted into after the crisis. So that's the tyranny of the usual, the assumption that nothing really changed. The second point you make, which is relevant to professionals, the tyranny of the usual, or the tyranny of the familiar, perhaps, is particularly likely to be true of any professional. So my reading of the history of medicine is, what was the famous line? Revolutions in ideas occur one funeral at a time. And it's true of economics, but it's also true of other subjects. It took a generational change for Keynesian economics to be accepted, and then another generational change for monetarist economics to be accepted, and the post-crisis mess in the post-70s mess in macro. So it takes generations to shift, because you're trapped by your own past, intellectual, the authority that your past gives you. It's very, very difficult to be flexible in response, and very few people are. Keynes was unique in this respect, never fully understood it, and it has some downside, because sometimes he was wild, but I think that's the second thing. So it is one revolution, one funeral at a time. I have no academic reputation, as it were, so I don't have anything to lose in this. But if you've been a Nobel Prize winner in macroeconomics, it's rather difficult to say you got the Nobel Prize for work that is in fact fraudulent. Now, the third, which is the situation, and the third, in my view, is, you're right, ideas have interests behind them. The ideas, interests are not very difficult to see. Clearly a world in which the only policy is monetary policy, and monetary policy works ultimately through the financial sector and through asset markets, is very favorable for some very, very powerful interests. I still think if that's all you've got, you use it. But it's clear why you end up in this situation, and you know very as well as I do who the interests are. So that's my answer. In the case of China, I perhaps would slightly qualify what I think you said, but I think I large in this respect. The cheap credit period was the period after the crisis, that is to say now 5 years ago. And it worked very well. It generated a staggering investment boom, a stagnating demand boom, and China was not affected by the crisis in the short run to any significant degree. Unfortunately, it left a huge hangover, giant hangover. Now, how do you deal with the hangover? Well, the hangover of cheap credit and excessive debt looks very like the sort of hangover we got in the developed world in different contexts. And so the way you deal with that, you have to restructure the debt. They're going to have to do that. They're going to have to recapitalize the financial sector. They know that anyway. They're going to have to find a new source of demand. I discussed that, because it can't just be investment. So how are they going to do that? That's not clear. That's not clear at all. And they're going to have to sustain credit without collapsing by reducing interest rates, not because it will lead to much more credit, because it won't, I think, in this situation, because it's going to allow people to afford the credit they have without mass bankruptcy in the system. So in mutatis mutandis, they're in the same situation in a post-credit boom phase as the US was in, say, 2008-9. The advantage the Chinese authorities have is that their underlying trend growth is higher. That's a big advantage. Their disadvantage is this macroeconomic problem coincides, as you indicate, with an immense structural transformation, a fundamental change in the development model. And I think what they're engaged in now is quite simply the most difficult process of adjustment and transition in a major economy I've ever seen. It's just enormous. And it's not surprising that they seem to show themselves in two minds at various stages. Are they going to rely on the equity market? Are they not going to rely on the equity market? Are they going to intervene or are they not? I think they've decided that intervening in the equity market was a big mistake. That's good. I think they've decided they're going to have to let the exchange rate go, but that's raising lots of problems, so they're now pumping in reserves. I think the truth is that this whole process of adjustment and transformation is now occurring in China more quickly than the authorities imagined, and they no longer feel completely in control of it. That's a guess. I haven't talked to them. And by the way, I suspect they're right. They are no longer completely in control of it, and that is now becoming the most important story in the world economy by far. The third question is the U.S. crisis proof, or how resilient is the U.S.? I'm not going to talk about the markets until, because I was asked that in the next question, and I hate forecasting markets because I always make a fool of myself, and I don't have to. My general point about the U.S. is this. U.S. is in principle the most resilient economic system in the world, in principle. It has immense assets in terms of capacity to make policy and the flexibility of its economic system. It obviously has lots of problems, that's clear. But if you compare it with anywhere else out there, it's not dependent on anybody else's credit, in all truth. It has a fully sovereign central bank, which issues the world money, and it has a very large amount of competitive business. So it's more resilient, I think, than the Europeans. But if a major further shock occurred in the US economy, probably emanating from outside, possibly combined with things inside, what I worry about is that the policy flexibility, apart from the Fed, doesn't exist. And the Fed is in important ways constrained as a result of legislative changes, Dodd-Frank, and changes, as I understand it, on the Fed law, which limit its capacity to act as a lender of last resort. Will that matter? I hope not, but that's the situation now. Finally, I thought, as a psychologist, you got it absolutely right. We have decided to force people to take private and personal responsibility for retirement investment. My view increasingly, I didn't hold this view 15 years ago, is that is asking people to do something of which they are incapable. And they are incapable for two reasons. One is the vast majority of people, for perfectly good reasons, have absolutely no idea how stock markets work, what they mean, how they operate. I sometimes think that includes most investment professionals, but I won't go into that. The second reason, so that's internal understanding. The second reason, which is much more important, is there are risks in the market that are unhedgeable, that are effectively unhedgeable. And these are risks relating to returns in the process of building up funds, the value of the fund and the point of retirement, and the post-crisis, the post-retirement returns. There are also immense deadweight costs of investing in the market as an individual because so much of the return is taken by the fund management industry or the investment management industry. And the reason for that is only partly that they're exploiting asymmetric information, though they sure are. A large part of it is they're engaged in a zero-sum advertising competition with one another, which involves huge deadweight costs. So I think that I have very little to offer because I think this is a terrible mess. I think we've gone far too far, particularly for most ordinary people, in making them individually responsible for their retirement provision, that alternatives are needed of a collective or semi-collective kind. We've moved some way in one way in the UK in this direction through the creation of very large national funds with very low costs. That's an improvement. I think pay-as-you-go systems like Social Security here have an essential role to play. I think we really have to think very carefully about whether this is a socially desirable development. My final point on that is that for many people in many countries, the development that we are seeing, and I think the US is an important example of this, is one in which retirement will become increasingly difficult. And what we will be discussing is not retirement, but situations in which people are working through the whole of their 60s and even into their 70s. And that creates a whole other set of problems in terms of labor market institutions and work possibilities. So I believe that the way we are handling retirement more broadly in the developed world is a tremendous mess. So I underline what you say and I've added a little bit to it, and it worries me substantially. But it's not an issue in my book, and I think I've covered all the questions.
Well, thank you so much for what has been a fantastic conversation, deeply substantive, a little depressing, to put it mildly, but a fantastically substantive discourse. Please join me in thanking Martin Wolf for being with us.